All right, good afternoon. I am Anto Budiarjo. This is Monday Live. This is something that we do every Monday afternoon at 3 p.m. to figure out the future for smart buildings. We are listed, or our profiles are listed on mondaylive.org, just in case you wonder who we are. And just to remind us all that the views expressed here are personal, not of any company or organization. Do post questions, comments on the Zoom chat so we can make this as interactive as possible. And as a reminder, this slide deck is on mondaylive.org if you need any of the links that may be on there. This being October, it is Cybersecurity Awareness Month. So cybersecurity is the topic of our month here, or the theme for our month. And so our agenda today, we're going to do our normal chit-chat and see where that goes. And then we're going to talk about Zero Trust. And we have a guest, Jason Garbis from AppGate, that I'll bring on once we get this thing going. And hopefully we'll have some interesting discussions. I think there's other people that's on the call that's also has a lot of knowledge about cybersecurity that we may want to bring into the conversation. But before that, hand it over to Mr. Sinclair. What's going on, Ken?
Thanks, Anto. The new issue is new website is working out well. I think it's been received well by the industry. We're starting to get the participation we'd hoped for. The fact that we can get stuff out timely is a big benefit, rather than waiting. Rather than storing this information for a month, we can actually get it out there on almost real time, which turns out to be pretty valuable. But that being said, we can do that on social media. But the problem is, on social media, it's very time sensitive and it kind of gets lost. And I don't know if it's just me, but when I try to find something that I've saw on social media, it almost seems to be hopeless to try and find the actual post I'm looking for. So I think there is an advantage to kind of organizing this stuff from a context point of view. And we're hoping that that's going to be our niche. We're learning daily what reinvention means, because we kind of reinvented ourselves and everything we touch is getting reinvented. So we wrote that story. Basically, it got published on Contractor magazine. Actually, the other thing that's kind of interesting there is I saw it picked up by the Los Angeles Chronicle, which is kind of interesting. So I'm thinking what we're seeing here too, as we start to reposition ourselves as an industry with a little bit more context to what it is we do and what our value is, I think we can get a little better coverage and connection to our to the industry. It's if everybody tells their story in their own words and uses their own metaverse presentations, I think that's going to help us raise our image. The other interesting discussion that goes on as we start to unroll the new website and have the folks involved in it is it's who is your metaverse handler? It's kind of an interesting thing, because we all now have a virtual persona, and we need somebody to handle that. There's so much going on. There's so many things we're involved in. We're involved in LinkedIn posts and Twitter posts, maybe, and also Zoom meetings and online conferences. And all of this information is rolling by us, all time-stamped in social media, but there's no one place you can kind of go and search and try and find out what's going on in the industry. We're kind of hoping that that'll be our niche. To augment that, I've just created some frequently asked questions to try to explain the interaction of the old site and the new site. And in addition to that, we're hard at our 12 education sessions for Atlanta, turning chaos into creativity. We definitely should have that online later this week. I was hoping to have it for Monday Live, but we're close, but not quite there. Back to you, Anto.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ken. It was interesting listening you introduce saying that the next issue is on the line, but there is no issue because it's just a perpetual issue, right?
So that's right.
All habits die hard. I was sort of looking at this over the weekend. Indonesia has a problem because their capital city, Jakarta, is sinking. I mean, literally, and it's got nothing to do with climate change. It's sinking at the rate of, at the worst part, 11 inches a year.
Wow.
11 inches a year.
That's huge.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, so they decided they could give it up and move and create a new city called Nusantara in Borneo, which you can see there on the map. And they want to make it sustainable and smart. So I thought this is interesting. It's obviously, it's going to take a couple of years to do, or a couple of decades. But that's what I thought was interesting. Yeah, it was built, the reason why it's sinking is it was built by the Dutch on the model of Amsterdam because they saw a lot of creeks and canals, except that they didn't really realize that the whole thing is on a swamp, so you can't do what Amsterdam is all about it because it just sinks as you build buildings, big buildings. So anyway.
A lesser known fact, I think, also, Anto, is that Indonesia, I think, is the fourth most populous country in the world. You know, it's one of those things for a quiz night, but yeah, it's fourth.
272 million, if my memory serves right.
Yeah, it's about, yeah.
Yeah, right. And one of them used to be me.
There you go.
So, any other thoughts or news or how's Croatia? Jim?
That's great, Anto. I'm in Zagreb, the capital city now. Just went to hiking in the national parks today. Just great. A lot of construction. There was a serious earthquake here at the beginning of the pandemic in 2000. So a lot of old buildings being restored right now to cover from that earthquake and quite a bit of smart building technology. So I've been checking it out. Mm-hmm.
Cool.
So, Anto, I attended the CRE Tech Show in New York last week on Wednesday and Thursday. And that show is focused on real estate oriented technology products and services. And I think the information I wanted to share with the audience here is there was absolutely a common theme on one word and one word only, and pretty much everybody knows what that word is, and it was data. I have to say that I don't think there was a company there that didn't emphasize their how their solution is leveraging data in one way or another. And this, you know, and it wasn't just, you know, the automation side of things. In fact, a lot of it was back office. But boy, I'll tell you, everything from identifying buildings to that you want to invest in, to managing your portfolio, to managing your taxes and regulations, to of course what we do in terms of trying to make the building smart. Everything was about data, and it was. There was one presentation I saw where they quoted statistics about integrations and said that major platforms like Salesforce have over 2,000 integrations that they support. Medium level platforms, if you will, that are publicly traded products but don't have the footprint of a Salesforce have 350 integrations.
Wow.
And small platforms that are not well known, mostly privately, and can be essentially startups or post startups, have an average of 15 integrations. So Yes. And so when I hear those kind of numbers, and we talk about the importance of APIs and so on, as we've done, you've got to admit that what's happening in the industry in terms of how all software is looking to integrate with other software is undoubtedly what's happening out there. And we're no different. We just got to be very cognizant of what the expectations are, because they are high. And it's just a given that you're going to have the ability to integrate.
And just to build on that, Steve, I think out of interest at the show, was there a lot of exhibitors?
The show was basically, it was a giant, not a giant, but it was a sizable trade show. And on either end, they had a couple stages, and then a couple smaller stages in between. And those were going on pretty much around the clock. And the largest stage, sort of the general session one, was curtained it off to try to keep the noise down a little bit. But the other one was interesting. They used these headsets. I don't know if you guys have seen this, where everybody wears a headset, and then the speaker conducts themselves from the stage, but you can only hear what's being said if you have a headset on. And that keeps the noise from those kinds of presentations from affecting the rest of the trade show.
And that, just out of interest, Steve, was there a ratio of IoT companies to, you know, standard building systems companies?
Yeah, well, there really weren't any building systems companies there. You didn't see any building automation, but you saw about 10 or so analytics platforms of one sort or another.
Okay, cool.
Yep.
Steve, I was on the reverse of that, and where there's something in London called the Smart Building Show, which was largely automation. So all the major automation companies were there, but there were a lot more sort of companies that actually were showing what to do with your data afterwards. I mean, Brian Turner's Buildings IoT were there, and companies like that. Mm-hmm. However, the two major discussions going around with everyone were, number one was just availability of products, and the other one was price increases. So some of the companies, especially with currency fluctuations, are putting their prices up 25%. Okay, 2.5%. And we all know when they go up, they're not going to come down.
Right.
But in addition to this, combined with the availability of components, which is still a huge issue, they're actually putting on a surcharge of something like 15% to try and get you to actually do that, so you get quicker delivery. But people are paying that, and including, I think one company is saying, it's £146 surcharge per controller, but they still can't deliver. So even if you pay the surcharge, it's just no availability. And so there's no availability. They're putting prices up 25%, and there's people with projects that are waiting for kit now, which is becoming a major problem for the industry here.
Yeah, absolutely.
But 25%, I've never seen that before in my lifetime, regardless of currency fluctuations.
That's significant.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, your comment about the number of integration is interesting, because I was just sort of wondering, on an average commercial building, sort of a downtown big commercial building, I wonder what is the number of integrations that will be required. I don't know.
Yeah, well, I think it's arguably it's going to be in the dozens.
At least
to start. But over time, the expectation is it's going to be in the, I would say 15 to 25 or more. Yep.
Okay, let's move on. If there's nothing else, talk about cybersecurity. I'm going to bring on our guest here, Jason. While he's coming on board, this has been our agenda for this month. We're not going to be talking about Zero Trust. We have a couple more shows on the topic of cybersecurity, talking about dynamic systems and BACnet. So with that, I'm going to stop my share and Jason should be with us now. Hello, Jason.
Hello, good afternoon. Can you hear me okay?
Good. Loud and clear. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for being with us. Could you introduce yourself, introduce your firm, AppGate, a little bit, and just sort of start out by talking about Zero Trust. I think you may have a slide or two that you want to share. Please do that as you see fit. Just sort of give us a sort of some background and starting point on this discussion.
Sure thing. And thanks Anto and all of you for allowing me to present today. I'm looking forward to it. I do have some slides which I think will help frame this up, but I do want this to be more of a conversation. So my name is Jason Garbus, and I'm Chief Product Officer at a company called AppGate. We are a software vendor, and we provide what's called a Zero Trust Network Access or ZTNA solution. We're a medium-sized company, I would say. We've got about 200 employees. So we've got a lot of great customers doing really interesting things. Outside from my employment role, I also have a role with a group called the Cloud Security Alliance, where I'm co-chair of the Zero Trust Working Group. And I recently authored a book on Zero Trust Security, which was published about a year and a half ago. One of the things that's not on my resume is building automation or smart building. So I'm definitely not an expert in that area. So that's okay. I think this will be a good counterpoint here. And it was interesting hearing you during the upfront portion talk about all of the technology changes and the reliance on data. And I think that ties in really, really well, and the integrations. And that ties really well into some of the problems that IT and security in general have been facing over the last decade or two. And I think part of the rationale for why we need this thing called Zero Trust to approach it and to really compensate for the inherent security flaws and challenges that come from our networking infrastructure and traditional security architectures. Any comments or questions from the group before I dive into this set of background slides?
Let's dive in.
All right, yeah, here we go. All right, let's do a screen check here. Make sure you can see the-
That's good. That's good.
Okay, excellent. So the premise is, I have a separate slide that we typically use for enterprise audiences, but I don't think we need that. I mean, you've touched on this as a group during the intro, and I think you all live this clearly, which is the proliferation of new technologies and new types of integrations and communications requirements in our IT infrastructure, and by extension in the world of smart buildings, has been pretty amazing. And you think about how much fun and how much new opportunity there is for businesses and for building operators, for real estate companies to take advantage of this new technology for tremendous benefit, with operational simplicity and new capabilities and efficiency and generated and doing interesting things with all this data. The challenge we have, and this is 100% true as well on the traditional enterprise IT side, is that the security teams are not able to keep up with the rate of change in technology. And we see the downside of this time and time again, every day practically, when there's a new ransomware attack that impacts some major organization or many, or there's a data breach of some sort. And the premise behind this is that we've really been hampered by traditional network security tools, networks themselves, and traditional security architectures that has made it a lot harder for us as an industry to really properly secure these types of infrastructures. So we'll talk about that, and pardon me, talk about this concept of Zero Trust, which is a security philosophy and an approach that really has been proven to be helpful. And then we'll talk about how in the smart buildings world or connected buildings world, we think that this can apply. So one of the two reasons that security has not been able to keep up is that our fundamental networking infrastructure, which was invented in the 1960s and 70s by brilliant people, amazing stuff that they were able to create with very, very crude and primitive technology at the time, this thing called TCP/IP, is a terrible foundation from a security perspective. It operates on this notion of implicit trust. It has no notion of security whatsoever, because we see this all the time, right? You get onto a Wi-Fi network or you plug into a hardwired Ethernet port, and immediately you're on the network, and guess what happens is that now you can see everything else on the network. And this was by design so that these systems could easily find and connect to one another. And it's only after you connect that there's any sort of authentication. And we see this time and time again in the public internet, where you go to a website and then you're prompted for credentials. Likewise, if you're using a technical system internally in your corporate environment, let's say your system administrator, you connect to a database server and you're prompted for credentials. And then you enter your credentials, you log in, and you do what you need to do. But the very fact that you've established a network connection is itself a security weakness and is something that violates what we call the principle of least privilege. And we think about our traditional VPN, which are 25-year-old technology and they're in use everywhere and they're terrible for a variety of reasons. You would never design a system like that today. What does a VPN do? Well, it sits at the entry point to your enterprise network and it advertises itself to every malicious actor on the planet saying, here I am, come and get me. And every malicious actor can establish a network connection to it. They can probe it. They can DDoS it. They can take advantage of stolen credentials. They can take advantage of known and unpatched vulnerabilities in the particular version of that VPN server. And we've seen this happen time and time and time again. That's the first premise here. The second premise is that our network infrastructure has a very poor, it's even too generous to call it a policy language. It's a rule language. And it forces us to use this very poor language to try to define security policies around what or who should be able to access what. And it forces us to answer this question, should this IP address here have access to that IP address or that subnet over there? And it also forces us to answer that as a binary yes or no, block or allow. And who can answer this question with any sort of authority? And the answer is no one, because nobody knows what device or system or human being is at that 192.168.4.11 address. We just have no context on that whatsoever. Yet our networking teams are required to have some sort of firewall rule that either allows or blocks that access. On the flip side, we probably don't know, maybe we know, maybe we don't, what system is sitting at 10.5.0.3. Is that a permanent IP address? Does it change? Is that our cafeteria menu? Is it our source code? Or is it, you know, something in between? And the result of this is that the networking teams really just focus on connectivity. They focus on delivering packets from one place to another reliably and efficiently. And users and systems, whether they're operated by our employees who are valid users or by malicious actors, they're allowed to get access to everything on the network. And the systems simply give up and say, okay, we're going to give you access and we're going to trust the authentication layer. Yeah, I know you can get access to our source code management system and attempt to log in, but you don't have a password. So that's going to have to be good enough. And as we've seen time and time again, that's fallen short and in very, very painful and expensive ways. So the solution is to use this security philosophy called zero trust. And we'll build up to kind of what that looks like. But first, let's talk about how this addresses the two shortcomings that we mentioned. So the first is that it actually takes this implicit trust model from TCP/IP and turns it on its head and says, you know what? We're going to require you to authenticate in some fashion. And there's different ways to do that, but we can think of it as we're just using cryptography, you know, certificate maybe, perform some sort of authentication before any sort of network connectivity is allowed. And only after you've authenticated or after the device has authenticated, does it get any sort of network connectivity. And then and only then does it get access to the very small subset of resources that it is authorized to access. So what this tells us is, number one, we have to be able to identify what the remote actor is so that they can authenticate, so that we can authenticate them. And two, we need to have an authorization model that says, oh, okay, we know who they are. And we have a model that says, based on that, we know they're only allowed to get access to these two things, not the 2,000 things on the network. The second area or way in which zero trust compensates for this is that it actually allows us to ask, to pose meaningful policy questions, such as this. Should Jim have access to our production SAP server? Great, that's an interesting question. And not only is it interesting because now we're asking about an identity. We know about Jim. We know what Jim's role is in the company. We also know about our SAP production server. Sounds like a pretty valuable asset. Probably want to restrict access to it. And the model also allows us to answer that question in the only possible way, which is the only possible answer is that it depends. And it depends on lots of interesting things that, guess what? As a security and identity and network ecosystem, we actually have access to all of these attributes. And now we can build a really interesting and really powerful policy model that lets us construct policies that say things like, oh, well, Jim's on the IT team, but he's on this project and he needs temporary access to this and he's on a currently patched system, therefore he should get access to this. Sally is on the finance team. Of course, she needs access to the SAP production server, but she only gets access to the user console, not the admin console, you know, that kind of thing. Much, much more meaningful. And these are policies essentially that are meaningful, not just to the networking team, but really to the business team, to the compliance team, to the application owner team, which is really where we want to get to. And that's one of the things that Zero Trust does really well, both from a policy perspective, as well from a technology perspective, is that it breaks down these barriers or gaps that are traditionally in place. Number one, at the bottom, you can see, and I think many of us have lived this, is they're completely different isolated access control systems that are traditionally in place. You've got a VPN for remote access, then you have something completely different that's used for on-premises access, some combination of a network access control system, sometimes called a NAC, or firewalls, or some other technologies that are there. Typically, even if they come from the same vendor, those have completely different rule sets. They oftentimes tie into different identity systems, and it just makes for a lot of additional work, and you end up with a significant mismatch between access that users get remotely versus on-prem. The second gap is the horizontal one which typically exists between application level access and network level access, where at the network layer, the network team simply says, hey, I'm moving packets really efficiently. I'm doing a great job. And I'm going to rely, or we're going to rely on application level authentication. Sure, you can pull up the login page to our production system, but you don't have a password. So I'm not too worried about it. And as we've seen time and time again, we do need to be worried about it. And in fact, the ability to send a network packet from a device to a server, the ability to establish a network connection, I believe is a privilege, you know, just as much a privilege as the ability to actually log into that application, because there's so many vulnerabilities that can be taken advantage of that don't require credentials. And we've seen this happen time and time again, that stuff needs to be shut down and to follow the default deny model, the principle of least privilege, and prevent that from happening at a network layer. I'm going to pause right there. I got a couple of slides next on what Zero Trust is and some architecture models that'll take us to the building automation space. But I'd love to see if there's questions or comments either from folks in the audience or from the panel here.
Jason, this is Dana. We chatted earlier, I think. And you may cover this shortly, but this is sort of very user-centric. Is there a Zero Trust model for device-centric systems, device to device, system to system, or is it just the same? It's just instead of a user person, it's a machine.
So if you look at some of the leading, I would say, independent research on this or resources, so things like the U.S. NIST organization, the National Institute for Standards and Technology, has published a pretty influential document called Zero Trust Architectures. It's special publication 800-207, and I'll show you a diagram from that shortly. Mm. Those things in general are, I would say, a little bit more focused on users and devices. They do a reasonable job of talking about non-human actors or non-person entities. It tends to be more server to server from that scenario. And the implication of that, okay, this is running the general purpose operating system, you know, it's Windows Server or Linux, I can install an agent on it. It's fully featured versus I'm talking about an IP camera where I can't install software, or an embedded device where I have to work with the manufacturer has to do this, and you know it's got a 5-year lifespan and can barely be updated, that kind of stuff. In the Zero Trust book that I write, my co-author and I do talk about this a little bit, and I can show you some diagrams in here. So we have a chapter on IoT, and I think that I'll definitely make sure that we get time to talk through those diagrams.
Yeah, I think cool.
So,
please.
Jason, there's a question that actually was also on my mind from Pete Scanlon. Are there sort of different approaches to do alternatives to zero trust? Is this one of many, or is zero trust is something that everybody has agreed to be concept that is that applies to all?
That's a good question. It's a zero trust is a strategy and a security philosophy. It's not a specific architecture, and it's actually not something that you can buy. So if a vendor says, "Hey, buy my product, then you'll have zero trust," you want to not necessarily believe them. Zero trust is definitely something that you do. Now, you there are products that you can buy that are better or worse to help you along that pathway, but zero trust is definitely an overall security philosophy and a strategy for an organization. So you can see here, NIST talks about it as it's a set of cybersecurity paradigms. And what it's doing is really moving from traditional perimeter-centric and static access control models to something that's much more dynamic and context sensitive. And in my view, it's really ties things into the broader ecosystem of your IT infrastructure, your business processes, and of course, your security infrastructure. And the second quote there is actually from President Biden. So there was a executive order that he issued about a year and a half ago, mandating that all federal agencies in the US take a zero trust approach. So this did a terrific job of being a catalyst for federal agencies to, of course, begin down their zero trust pathways, but it also prompted and has resulted in a pretty visible set of public projects across agencies, both DOD and civilian agencies, talking about zero trust and publishing documents and explaining kind of how they're going down their pathway. So if you think about zero trust, there's four core tenets or principles from around this, and this is from NIST. So the first is that all communication is secured regardless of network location. And what this really means is no matter where the user is, whether they're at home or in an office, no matter what resource they're accessing, or even if it's server to server access, that communication needs to be secured. And that means more than just encrypting the traffic. It means that it needs to follow a principle of least privilege, and the access, getting to the second tenet, needs to be enforced by a set of dynamic policies. So I talked about the policy for GIM, or potential policy for GIM accessing the SAP servers. And that's a great example of a dynamic policy. So if I flip back to that for a second, we might have a policy that says, people on the finance team are allowed to access the SAP servers web interface if they're in the United States and they're running the corporate device that's up to date and has their antivirus running. That's a pretty reasonable policy. And that's something that a zero trust system, if you think about that policy, it often for the first time pulls together dimensions or attributes that have never been possible to enforce in one place before. You're looking at device information, you're looking at identity group information, you're looking at geolocation, and you're looking at maybe even something like, is there a service desk ticket that's open that assigns Jim access to this because it's maybe he's an admin and he has to fix something. Authorization and the authentication is dynamic and strictly enforced. What we're meaning by that is there's no implicit access. The system has to follow the principle of least privilege, and you're not going to get access to anything, or an identity is not going to get access to any resource until and unless it's positively authenticated and it has a policy evaluation occurs where the attributes of the identity and the device and the system they're trying to access are evaluated, and that access is authorized, that access is assigned to them, essentially. And then the last bullet point is, of course, the enterprise needs to know what's on their network, and they need to monitor the activity on the network and monitor the traffic, as well as the configuration of those devices. Now, if we think about, this is from the NIST document, and there's a couple of concepts in here. So the first is that there's this notion of, up at the top here, this thing called a policy decision point, or PDP, and that's the brain of the system, if you will, that's going to make these determinations around should a subject, should an identity be permitted to access a given resource at this point in time. And the PDP can only make that decision if it has enough information about the identity, about the device it's using, and about the resource that's attempting to be in, it is attempting to access, as well as about the overall environment. And that's really where the power of Zero Trust comes in, is it's not a standalone system, is that you can see these eight boxes on the left and the right side that are examples of the types of things that really need to be tied in to make Zero Trust useful and powerful for an enterprise. So looking at, of course, identity information such as group membership, endpoint information, so you can get information about, is this device patched that the user is using? Is my antivirus running? Does it have my corporate certificate installed, et cetera? But also looking at things like maybe threat intelligence or, my SIM system. You know, is there anomalous activity on the network? Do I know of a particular attack that's utilizing, let's say, Windows file share that's active right now that I want to be more careful about? Can I have the ability to integrate with my identity system and require step-up authentication? Can I integrate with my IT service management help desk so that I'm using a business process to control access to a given resource? And that last use case is one of my favorite use cases for Zero Trust, because it ties together things that have been very difficult or usually impossible to do before, which is a business process, in this case, opening the help desk ticket, for example, and network level access. So we'll jump to the chase here. I mean, imagine we're in a building management system world, and a vendor needs to connect to a building management system that's running thousands of miles away in a building that doesn't belong to them, right? It belongs to one of their customers. But their technician has to access an HVAC system to update the firmware or do some diagnostics or something. So typically that's done with a VPN, which has a variety of problems and limitations. But in a Zero Trust system, you could say, great, I'm going to create a service desk ticket in my service management system, assign it to user Sally Jones. And only when that ticket is open, now the Zero Trust system interrogates, which has an integration with the service desk system. And it says, oh, Sally has a ticket assigned to her that says she needs to log into HVAC system 12, you know, at building 35 in Chicago. And now Sally immediately gets network access to securely connect into that building management system. And that's the only thing on the network she can connect to. She logs in, she fixes the problem. And then as soon as she closes the ticket, that network access goes away. So it's a beautiful example of tying together a business process, which you want to do for lots of different reasons, and enforcing that on the network layer. And it eliminates Sally's 24/7/365 access, which is typical with a VPN. So that completely goes away as an attack surface. And it allows the organization to have complete control and in an audit proof and self-documenting way around that. So I'll pause right there. And next up, the next handful of slides talk about IoT scenarios, which I think will be near and dear to everyone's heart.
Let's jump into that, shall we?
Okay, sure thing. So the rough picture here is that there's a couple of policy enforcement points, and one of them is on the left side, you can see is called an IoT connector, and the one on the right side is just a generic PEP. And the details don't matter, right? This is the slides I'm showing you happen to be AppGate slides because our product does this, but I've genericized them, and the technical details don't matter so much. What's important is that the only way to get access to or from those IoT devices on the left side is through this IoT connector. And between the IoT connector, which you can think of, this is running on the same network in the building as all these devices. And then you've got this encrypted tunnel. And this is, in this case, it's a mutual TLS tunnel to some remote policy enforcement point that sits in front of the data center resources. But it also logically sits in front of the user, in this case, the client, the user's device that's running the client agent. So you can see what happens in this point. In this example is maybe I've got my IP cameras on the left, And they need to push video up to the video server that's running in my centralized data center. So they can do that across the secure connection here. And I'm ensured that, number one, the traffic's encrypted, which it probably isn't natively from this little cheap camera. Number two, that camera, even if it gets compromised, can't access anything else in my data center. It's only allowed access to that one thing. So of course I care if it gets compromised, but I don't care that much. And number three, the user device, the client agent that's running on the user device there, also the system also permits downstream traffic. So now I can control what devices and when my client, my user, is permitted to access. And in this example, the network traffic goes from the user here to, whoops, sorry about that, to this policy enforcement point, and then through this tunnel down to the device. So now I can, like in my example of Sally, I can only allow this agent access to maybe one webcam or all the webcams if that's his job, but he can't get access to the printers or the VoIP phones, et cetera. And we think about this, what it does is it solves a number of problems. One is it makes it so that even if that device is compromised, number one, or maybe someone has physical access to it and they can take over, or maybe they have physical access and they can unplug it from the Ethernet cable that it's using and plug in their own device, that they're not permitted to do very much, if anything, with that connection. Number two, it encrypts the traffic to compensate for what's typically unencrypted native network traffic. It also allows for securing user access to those devices in a controlled way and restricts what else on the upstream network they're allowed to connect to, so that even if those devices are compromised, we know that, okay, yeah, I can maliciously try to do something on my video server, but it can't do port scan and it can't do reconnaissance across my corporate network. And it's reducing what's called the blast radius. So I know my IP cameras are insecure. If one of them gets compromised, I'm not happy, you know, but I can detect this pretty quickly because it's only allowed to access the video server. And if it tries to do anything else, I know immediately something's up and I can quarantine it. And I'm preventing it from doing anything else on my network so that it can't be the initiator for some big ransomware attack. This picture is kind of a repeat of what I said around restricting those devices. And again, obviously this is an AppGate slide, but you can think of this as generic zero trust policy enforcement points. And I'm gonna skip this slide because there's a better one, which is this one. So I think this is just a cleaner view of, you can imagine I've got users on the left side and maybe they're sitting in headquarters or maybe they're working from home, it doesn't matter, is that they get authenticated and they get authorized and then they get secure access through this local policy enforcement points that sits at the entry point to my building. And then they're allowed to access downstream to my building IoT system or the IP cameras, whatever it is that's assigned to them based on their role and based on the policies that look at their device and their time of day, or maybe the service desk ticket. And then likewise, the upstream access from these cameras or the IoT system goes up through the PEP and then into my headquarters to whatever systems they're allowed to get access to, but only to those systems. So I'll pause there. I've got a couple yeah, go ahead, please.
Jason, yeah, I have a question in the previously where you were showing the IoT things, I mean, and then comparing it with this slide, they're all isolated and going to the cloud. In this one, you're showing them going through some sort of middleware that acts as a PEP. I mean, a lot of the idea is at the moment is a lot of the devices are going directly, you know, when we're talking about devices going directly to the cloud and stuff, mm-hmm. where you're suggesting that it needs to go through some sort of middleware to manage that connectivity now, as opposed to individual devices going directly?
There's a couple of things behind what you mentioned. So one of them is clearly in the examples that I'm showing here, these devices need access to, in this example, let's say some servers that are running in your headquarters. So that's one scenario. And of course, in many cases, these servers may not be in your headquarters, and they may be running in a cloud environment, and they may not even belong to the, they may belong to a third party. The answer to that is that, yes, there needs to be a policy enforcement point that's running on the local network with these devices. And you want to control both inbound and outbound. It's definitely the case that these systems should not have unfettered access outbound to the internet. If they have to connect to systems upstream, it's very important to understand what those are and the reason that they're connecting to those. I mean, if it's maybe they connect upstream to a vendor, a patch server to get updated firmware or check for updates or things like that. And that probably should be allowed. It might be something that you would want to have more control over, like, and only restrict it to off hours, maybe weekends or evenings or things like that. And you should definitely prevent it from accessing random sites on the internet. You should definitely have some sort of DNS filtering in your system so you can block known bad sites or things like that. So yes, and you can think of this as middleware, or you can think of it as some sort of network security firewall that sits in between. And that's not always easy to do on these very messy enterprise networks, which kind of brings us to the next set of diagrams here. I mean, you can think of, here's my kind of generic enterprise network, and I got lots of stuff running on it. And some of them are hardwired, like let's say an IP camera that's in the ceiling, and some of them are wireless. Or some combination, like maybe a printer has both. And the challenge in many cases, in the ideal scenario, you would have these homogeneous subnets, and maybe there are these things called VLANs where they're all kind of logically separate. Maybe they're segregated to a fixed IP range so that you know, okay, all my IP cameras are in this logical place, and I can put this policy enforcement point in front of them. And I can be sure that the only way to get traffic in and out goes through that policy enforcement point. And that's kind of the ideal scenario, because these cameras are closed systems. They're not running, you know, Linux or Windows. You can't install software on them or things like that. In many cases, of course, that's not the case. You have a heterogeneous network and you've got a bunch of different devices on there, and you may not have a really good picture. You may not have control over which gets which IP address, and as things have their leases time out, or if there's a power cycle or something, you may get, you know, randomly assigned IP addresses. And that's a lot more challenging. There's definitely ways that can be done through at different layers, and we don't have time to go through all of that. But in general, there are reasonably bulletproof ways to do a lot of this. They do require some changes to the network, but it's not going to be terribly invasive. And in general, you can, without a huge amount of effort, typically get into a situation where you do have this policy enforcement point that sits in front of these devices and controls access, that gives you the leverage you need to now be able to say, all right, I can control traffic that's outbound, and I can control traffic that's inbound.
There's a question from Pete about he was referring to the IoT devices potentially being on a separate network, but I think that's not your point here, right? Your point is that they all of these devices are effectively on the same network, although they're kind of different parts. Can you just sort of touch on that a little bit?
That's right.
Because there's one of the big conversations in buildings is the sort of the concept of a converged network as opposed to separated networks. That's the motivation of the question.
Okay. They do not have to be on separate networks. And the reason that I'm hesitating a little bit, of course, is that there's separation can happen at different layers, right? You can have separate physical networks with different cabling. You can have separate logical networks with these things called VLANs that are essentially like separate networks like this. Or you could have a network where everything runs in the same network and they all talk to the same DHCP server and they all get random IP addresses in the same range, which is a lot harder to do. But there are typically ways to control that, whether you're using an old-fashioned network access control that does some device recognition, some types of equipment or IoT devices have management layers where you can pre-configure IP addresses or IP ranges that they get, et cetera. There's a variety of ways that you that you can do that.
Jason, in the zero trust world, there's a high reliance on someone setting all this up and configuring, right? And identifying who has access to what and et cetera, et cetera. In the context of applying zero trust to the IoT or the building systems, where do you think that responsibility lays? Does that responsibility lay with the IT folks, the cybersecurity guys, or the building management people? And I know it's probably a subjective question, but what would be your view?
I don't have a single answer for that. And it's, I can imagine in different scenarios, you have different people who are responsible for different layers. In my experience in the enterprise world, it typically is driven by the security team, but you've got IT and you've got the application owners, all of whom are stakeholders in that. And that's one of the things about zero trust, that it's inherently cross-functional, which can make it a challenge for organizations. And for security teams, it can take them a little bit out of their comfort zone, because security folks, like me, tend to love technology, and oftentimes they want to just focus on the technology or to geek out on the security aspects of things instead of realizing, okay, I need to understand what the business value is and what the business driver is and be able to communicate that and to get the application owners on my side and get the business on my side, because these things will result in some changes to the network, to the user experience, to the application owners. And done properly, it's not going to be disruptive, and it's actually going to open the doors to some new types of innovation. And I see Matt's question there about how do we do this without bringing things to a grinding halt?
Right.
And it's, the key is to do this thoughtfully and to realize that this isn't an overnight big bang type of thing. It's, you want to start with, start small and understand, okay, what am I trying to protect first? And how do I get started with that to understand who the users are so that we can start to put in place some sets of controls that are sensible and strong around the higher value things to start with. I mean, clearly you don't want to start with the highest value thing first, because you got to get some experience with your platform, your tools, and your people and things like that. But I found working with enterprises, just general IT, that there's almost always some good pain points that a security team can start with. They work with their peers, they talk to the organizations, they put their ear to the ground, and they can learn, oh, there's a project over here to onboard this new technology and it's struggling. Or everyone hates this tool over here for this reason. Maybe we can use this as an opportunity to get rid of that pain point. Maybe there's a team that's looking to do some cloud migration and they're struggling because the security team won't let them or forces them to do things in an old-fashioned way that's incompatible or a pain in the neck with a modern cloud environment. So it's really about doing this incrementally and doing it stepwise so that, and knowing what you're doing, meaning learning about your environment and the way that the access or the transaction flows work so that you're not going to grind things to a halt.
One of the things that's going through my head, hearing your presentation towards the beginning, is that trying to sort of understand what's the bad side of this. Obviously for security, there shouldn't be. I mean, there isn't if you do it right. But it seems to me that there can potentially be a lot of complexity, especially if you don't think through stuff, or maybe if you rush stuff or you're trying to do complex stuff. Is that a good way of thinking about what you have to consider? Zero trust.
It does get complex, and a lot of times the complexity comes in when you're dealing with these really complicated enterprise networks that have redundancy, different multiple access methods to get to various things. So when you're trying to put a policy enforcement point in place and say, okay, I'm going to put this in the DMZ at the entry point to the network, and you talk to the enterprise and they say, well, okay, but we have this redundant wide area network so that, you know, which we built for perfectly reasonable reasons, which was if this entry point is down for our VPN, they can go in over here and then the traffic can go around the long way and they can still get to this stuff. So it adds a lot of complexity. Another area of complexity is that because we have these pretty traditional security architectures that have traditional jigsaw puzzle pieces of a certain size and shape. Okay, this is my VPN and it does this. This is my NAC, it does this. This is my endpoint management system, it does that. That zero trust platforms often span those things or it'll cross over. And it can make it difficult from a technical perspective or even from a budgeting perspective to say, all right, I'm trying to champion zero trust here at this organization. You know, but the problem is that I've still got 2 years left on my NAC solution that is, you know, 2 years of depreciation left. My finance team won't let me spend on this stuff. I am authorized to buy this for a VPN replacement, but you know, it's got to fit into this exact size and shape VPN puzzle piece. And that can complexify things where, for example, one of our customers had a traditional VPN that they were replacing, but they had built this kind of web of dependencies around it. They relied on the VPN client to, when I think it was captive portal, when some event happened on the client, that it sent a certain event into the Windows event log. And they'd written a script that monitored that and did something in response to that. And it was just a simple example around, okay, now we have to realize that we either have to match that login or they have to change this other part of their environment, which of course that team didn't own. So it added an additional dependency. So it's harder to do this in a bigger and more complicated enterprise environment. It's harder to do this if you don't have the strategic buy-in from the enterprise's IT and security leadership. And if you do, then great, you can change people's motivations, you can knock down walls, you can say, no, we're gonna you know, get rid of that dumb script that no one liked anyway, and we're gonna do it this way.
And so just to that point, Jason, are there, other than yourselves, I mean, I can see this is a really complex thing to get into an organization. Are there consultancies, experts, are there training environments to get folks up to speed on zero trust implementations?
Yeah, there's a lot of terrific resources that are available out there. I would definitely recommend, you know, the NIST document the set of NIST documents is excellent. You know, my book is good. There's a new book that came out that I actually just read. It's called Project Zero Trust, and it's fiction. It's a story. I don't know if any of you read the Phoenix Project, but it's very much like that, except it's around zero trust. So it's an entertaining and educational read. There are definitely organizations that have some sort of certifications and training around this. So Forrester Research has one. The Cloud Security Alliance is finishing up a zero trust training course. I'm not aware of other kind of certifications, but there are a lot of resources out there, and it's a fun area. It can be complicated for sure.
Okay, so we're coming up to a wrap here. Thank you very much, Jason. There you are. Sorry, moved around. Thanks. That was a phenomenally comprehensive introduction, I think. Very well appreciated by the Monday Live crew and the audience, and I think we need to wrap it because we're past the hour. So I just want to thank you and thank the audience and thank for the panelists, and we'll get a video on this, and I'm sure people will be interested in watching this presentation from the video.
Great, thanks for having me. I enjoyed it, and I'm happy to follow up. You can find me on LinkedIn. You can find me on Twitter with the handle Jason Garbus, and really appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you, Jason.
Okay.
Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
Great.
Thanks, Jason.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See y'all. Thanks. Bye. Thanks.